Last Christmas, my girlfriend got me this bucket list poster of 100 movies to watch. It's pretty cool, got some good stuff on here, but the problem is, I've seen like 90% of the movies because I watch way too many movies.
Not to worry.
She came out with a genius solution. I am to rewatch all the movies before I can check them off the list. So let's do a little. That means I have to watch 8.3 movies a month, or just under 2 a week.
Now that's f***ing dope, huh?
So let's check the progress. I've watched 21 movies from the list now, minus the 11 movies that I watched the last 2 months, making that 10 movies for the month of March. That is putting me back on track to complete this challenge, as I was a little behind last month.
Let's get to it.
So I watched this last month, but I forgot to include in last month's video. Oops. Reservoir Dogs is my shit. This is Quentin Tarantino's first film and is a masterpiece. It is about a group of diamond thieves after a job went sour, trying to figure out who the mole in the group is. All the usual praises one would give a Tarantino movie, this movie has in spades. Great dialogue, insane violence, but no feet shots.
Shame.
This has an incredible cast. Harvey Keitel, Tim Roth, and Steve Buscemi give some of their best performances to date. I especially love Steve Buscemi in this movie, as I haven't really seen him do anything that amazing. I haven't seen Boardwalk Empire or Fargo, so maybe I'm missing out on peak Buscemi. Who knows?
Do you think God stays in heaven because he too lives in fear of what he's created?
Most of the film takes place in one location. A warehouse which was a meetup spot for after the robbery. This one location was designed so well, with a ramp on one side to create some elevation for characters, so it's not just a flat floor. I feel like this was designed like a stage play, creating interesting levels and depths to the warehouse, like how a stage design would be conducted. I'm planning on doing a full analysis on Tarantino's filmography in the future, so I'm gonna leave this Reservoir Dogs discussion here, and just say it's a 5-star film. I loved it. I guess you're gonna just have to subscribe if you wanna hear me talk more about this film. This movie is absurdly long. Unless it's Lord of the Rings or The Irishman, I don't want to watch a 4-hour fucking movie. This is a Bollywood movie directed by
Ashutosh Gowarikar.
It is set in British-controlled India in the 1890s, and is about an Indian village challenging a British commander to a game of cricket in hopes to abolish their extremely high taxes. It's a pretty generic sports movie about a group of ragtag, undertrained underdogs working together, showing teamwork and determination to beat the opposition. Reminding me of movies such as Remember the Spartans, The Longest Yard, and Rocky. And as it was a Bollywood movie, it is jam-packed with songs and dances. Normally that would be a plus for me, as I love musicals, but I'm here to say that I wasn't a big fan. The songs were all very obviously dubbed over, making it not very convincing that they were actually being sung. The choreography was real enjoyable though, lots of great dances all being done in unison. A big problem that I had with this movie is the fact that there were way too many characters and none of them were very complex. They were all broken down to maybe one or two characteristics each, reminding me of some very simple, basic Simpsons characters. This guy is the bad boy, then there's the religious guy. This one's a short guy. This guy had some chickens. I don't really remember this guy. That's the main character. That guy had a drum. This guy just showed up? Oh, and that one was the cripple. You'd think that with a 4-hour runtime, you might be able to flesh out some of the characters, but no. There was also a very forced love triangle between the main character, an Indian girl, and the sister of the main villain. Very forced, and I don't really feel like it led anywhere. Overall, this movie was far too long and derivative of other movies in the genre. The only thing that holds up for me in this movie is the fact that it wasn't too boring, and the cricket scenes were actually kind of fun and exciting. Much more exciting than real cricket, in fact. 3 stars. There was actually a bit in the movie where they argued about the rules of the game that kind of reminded me of the infamous underarm bowling incident of 1981. This is where the bloody Australian team straight up cheated against the New Zealand team, bowling underarm to stop New Zealand winning the game, actually leading to the New Zealand's Prime Minister to make a statement where he famously said, "This is the most disgusting incident I can recall in the history of cricket." What can I say? We take sports very seriously in New Zealand. This bucket list poster loves Pixar movies way too much. There are 3 Pixar movies on here, and yet it doesn't include the best Pixar movie, The Incredibles? That's ridiculous. Anyway, Up was okay. Obviously the cliche is saying that the first 10 minutes is exceptional and made me cry. That's just factual. If the movie had stopped after this 10 minutes, it would be my favorite short film ever. But unfortunately, that is not the case. It is about an old man and a boy scout who go on an adventure in a flying house to South America, as it was the dream of the old man's late wife to go to Paradise Falls. It goes without saying that the animation was beautiful, as Pixar has really been the pinnacle of 3D animation for decades now. I still prefer 2D animation or stop motion personally, but I do respect and appreciate good 3D animation when I see it. The story is very lackluster though, not being very groundbreaking or too interesting. I also hate the dog characters, which I feel bring this movie to a screeching halt. I think there's a great movie within here somewhere. Maybe if you cut the dogs and the giant bird, and make it more about the old man and the Boy Scouts relationship, it would be a much better movie. I don't know, just riffing. I've given this 2.5 stars, the animation and the first 10 minutes doing most of the heavy lifting for this rating. As Pixar movies go, I wouldn't really recommend it. There are way better ones to choose from. Before I watched this movie, I'd seen The Holy Grail like a million times. I love that movie. The Monty Python comedy troupe is so hilarious, essentially performing sketch comedy segments with a loosely linked story holding it all together. I'd been meaning to watch more of this stuff, but I never got around to it until now. The Life of Brian is great, being largely a parody of the Bible, but following a guy called Brian, who's just living his life while Jesus is doing, you know, whatever Jesus does. Brian rebels against the Romans and is seen by some as a prophet, even though he is just a regular guy. This movie is so damn funny, making me laugh out loud basically the entire time. The production quality was relatively low though, as the costumes and sets looked like a stage play, not being very detailed or realistic. That's not necessarily a bad thing though, as the stage play look and feel resembled the roots of the Monty Python comedy troupe, seeming like the movie was just a filming of a live show that they were running. I've given this 3.5 stars, not as good as The Holy Grail, which I gave 4 stars. Life of Brian is more of a narrative than The Holy Grail though, but it isn't as funny. 2001 A Space Odyssey is basically the peak of cinema. This is one of my favorite movies of all time and one of Stanley Kubrick's best works. And I don't even know how to describe the plot. It is about the advancement of humankind and artificial intelligence. It is such a deep and insightful film, and I have new interpretations every time I watch it. I showed it to my friend Richard recently, who had never seen it before, because he used to be in a controlling cult that wouldn't let him watch TV. We recorded a review of it.
Here's a clip!
You know, if you're saying the people sent the monoliths to give us some instructions in hopes that we would soon have pots and pans to make things easier and preferably air fryers,
yeah.
But actually what we ended up with was axes and clubs and guns and shit.
Oh my!
Axes and clubs and guns and...
Oh my!
An obvious 5-star film. Please watch it if you haven't seen it. Back to the Future is one of those classic films that I feel like everyone's already seen, or at least they're planning to in the future. This movie is about a teenager who travels back to 1955 and has to struggle with the urge to fuck his own mother. He has to make his mom and dad fall in love or it will mean that he was never born. This movie recreated the 50s so well, with great set designs and costuming. Make me feel like this movie is plucked straight out of the 50s. The two main actors are pretty great, Michael J. Fox and Christopher Lloyd giving excellent performances. Alan Silvestri's score is so iconic and memorable. Every time I watch this movie, I always have the theme song stuck in my head because it is just so catchy. My biggest issue with this film is the fact that the time travel contradicts its own rules and doesn't really make sense. I guess I don't expect this fun family movie to be as detailed and consistent as Primer or 12 Monkeys, but I do get a bit frustrated watching this, not being able to get the time travel problems out of my head. I've given this movie 4 stars. I actually like the sequel to this movie much better than this one. I kinda like how that movie is set in a future that was imagined from 1989. Very interesting. The third one is kinda boring, wouldn't recommend that one. This is another movie by Robert Zemeckis, and I think it's as good, if not better, than Back to the Future. Tom Hanks plays one of his best roles of his career, as we follow his character Forrest Gump as he goes through his exceptional life. He isn't very intelligent and sort of just fumbles through life. Forrest goes through various 20th century famous events, like the Vietnam War, hanging out with Elvis, and meeting many of the US presidents. It is very fun to see these famous events through his perspective, giving its own unique spin on how to perceive certain events. He is infatuated by Jenny, his childhood sweetheart who he wants to marry. But Jenny is just a real bitch. It leads him on, abandons him, and treats him like crap. I fucking hate Jenny. And maybe I'm meant to hate her, but even so, she just really pisses me off. Just let Forrest be happy, Jenny. Robin Wright admittedly does a pretty good job playing Jenny, really making me hate her guts. They use real footage of famous events from history within the movie, with Forrest edited into the footage. I kinda wish they'd recreated the scenes instead, as the effects were very dated, especially when they edited the mouth movements of people so they could be dubbed with new dialogue. I've given this 4 stars, and I do really enjoy it, but I feel like this is kind of mindless family fun. I don't really get too much emotion or meaning out of this film, apart from a burning hatred towards Jenny. Dirty Dancing is a really great coming-of-age story as the main character Baby.
Your name's Baby. B-A-B-Y Baby.
Falls in love and learns to dance while she's on holiday with her family. This movie is very fun, getting to see Patrick Swayze and Jennifer Grey dance, have fun, and fall in love. The main draw for this movie is the great choreography, with some very exceptional dance scenes. The big final dance scene at the climax of the film is breathtaking. There was a lot of themes that I didn't expect from this film, covering such things as abortion and class divides between the elite and the working class. It kind of took me by surprise, as I had seen this when I was younger, but didn't remember it too much. The best part of the film was when the asshole character said,
"Some people count, some people don't. Read it. think it's a book you'll enjoy, but make sure you return it. I have notes in the margin.
When he gave her that copy of The Fountainhead by Ayn Rand, I fucking lost my shit. And the guy kinda looks like Paul Ryan as well. So funny. Ultimately though, the movie's a bit dated in its sound quality, and there are a lot of boring side characters that take up way too much time. Given this 3.5 stars, I haven't seen the 2017 remake of this movie. Maybe I should to torture myself a bit. This is the funniest movie I've seen all month. Airplane, is a spoof film about an airplane flight that goes sour when people start dying from food poisoning from the plane food, including the pilots. I don't even want to show footage of this movie, as this movie is driven by its humor, especially its sight gags, and I don't want to spoil anything. If you haven't already, please watch Airplane. You'll be on the ground in a few minutes laughing your ass off. Sadly, after one watch, I feel like I got everything out of this movie. Like, it was very funny, but nothing too much more than that. I can't wait for a few years to go past so I can forget all the jokes and watch this movie again. I've given this 4 stars, please go watch it. Who doesn't love Pulp Fiction? This may be one of the most famous movies ever made.
Any of you fucking pricks move and I'll execute every motherfucking last one of you!
Very nice, honey. Pulp Fiction, anybody? Right? It's a classic. We love films.
This is Quentin Tarantino's 1994 masterpiece, following 3 main characters, Jules, Vincent, and Butch, as they live their gangster lifestyles. This movie is formatted very uniquely, being set out in 3 main segments, each following a different character. It is basically an anthology film with overlapping characters and themes. The 3 main actors, Sam Jackson, John Travolta, and Bruce Willis, give some of their best performances to date. Definitely in the case of Travolta, which I'd go so far as to say that this is his only good role ever.
You can't stop my happiness, cause I like the way I am. You just can't stop my knife and fork when I see a Christmas ham.
All the side characters are amazing as well, especially Harvey Keitel's character, The Wolf. The Wolf is so suave and cool, I just want to be him. This is probably one of my favorite movies of all time, so it's kind of unfair that it's on this bucket list, but that's just how it is. An obvious 5-star film. As I said before, I'll probably do a best director video on Tarantino and his filmography, so stay tuned for that. Schindler's List is widely considered pretty great, especially since it swept the 1993 Academy Awards. It is a Spielberg drama based on the true story about a wealthy man profiting off the Holocaust and the war who grows fond of the Jewish people working for him and attempts to help them escape. This movie is filmed in black and white, which I'm usually not a big fan of, but I feel like it is exceptionally pulled off in this movie, especially since some spots of color are used to accentuate some characters and situations. Liam Neeson does an excellent performance, probably a career best. The score is probably the best part of this film. John Williams hitting it out of the park with this one. Listen to it played on the violin by young Ben Shapiro. Stunning music. This movie is a bit long and tedious though, not really holding my attention the entire time. Still really like it and glad I watched it again. 4 stars. So that's my list for the month of March. April should be a big list as I'm home on lockdown in New Zealand, so lots of time to watch movies. Christopher Nolan Best Director video coming out soon. And me and Richard are also going to do another review, maybe on Star Wars, coming out soon. So stay tuned.
Did you love it? Did you hate it? What would you rate it? You're the best. What should I review next?